Welcome to lecture 3 of the course Representations of Finite Groups. In the last class, we defined what is an irreducible representation. We also defined what is a completely reducible representation and what is a decomposable representation. Okay, so today we are going to explore these ideas further, and hopefully we will be able to prove Haskell's theorem, which says that every complex representation of a finite group is completely reducible. That is, you can write it as a direct sum of finitely many irreducible representations. And once you prove this theorem, then the whole focus will be try to understand these irreducible representations of a given group. All right. So let us begin with this proposition, which I stated orally in the last class, that all these notions of irreducibility, decomposability, and complete reducibility, they are invariant under equivalence of representation. That is, if you have two representations which are equivalent, then if one representation is irreducible, completely reducible, or decomposable, then so is any representation equivalent to this. All right, that's what we expect. So let us begin with this proposition. If, let us say, phi from G to GLV is a representation that is equivalent to a decomposable representation then phi is also decomposable. Okay, it's very easy, so but nevertheless, just for the sake of completeness, let me prove it. So let us say psi from G to GLW be a representation such that phi is equivalent to psi. So what is the definition? That is, there exists an isomorphism of vector spaces, let us say T from V to W, such that this diagram commute. So you have from V to V, such that, so for each group element G, we have the following commutative diagram. So V to V and W to W. So V to V, you have phi sub G. From V to W, we have these isomorphisms T. And here you have this psi G. So what you want is that phi G, okay, from here to here should be same as you apply T first, then psi G, and then T inverse. Okay, this is what we know. All right, so now what is given to you is that psi is decomposable. So suppose that psi is decomposable. So what is decomposability? That means, that is, I can write my vector space W as W1 direct sum W2, where each Wi is not equal to 0, okay, and each Wi is G invariant. That is, I can decompose my W as a direct sum of two proper G invariant subspaces. And my claim is that my original representation phi is also decomposable, right? So there is an obvious choice of subspaces of V. So take Vi to be, take Vi to be, well, so you have this T from W to V. So take it to be T is invertible linear transformation, T inverse of Wi for I equals to 1, 2, right? Take this. So then Vi is a subspace of this. All right, and T is an isomorphism. So in fact, Vi is isomorphic to Wi. So Vi is not, Wi is a non-zero, so Vi's are also non-zero, right? And claim is that V can be written as V1 direct sum with V2. V1, V2 are also G invariant. Okay. So let V belong to V1 intersection V2. We belong to V1. We also belong to V2. All right. But that's what are Vi? So that implies that T of V belong to W1 intersection W2, right? But that's given to be trivial because this is a direct sum. Okay. And therefore, which implies that V has to be itself trivial because T is an isomorphism, T is injective, right? So therefore, V1 intersection V2 is also trivial. And similarly, you can show that V1 plus V2 is also whole of the vector space because any element of, if you take any V in V, right? So its image is in W. So that's a direct sum of little W1 plus little W2 and pull them back, right? So this proves the first claim. And their G invariant is also immediate. So how to really write it down? So next is, let us say, so if V belong to, let us say, Vi, and G belong to G, then we know that Wi is G invariant, right? So T of V is an element of Wi, and that is G invariant under the second representation, that is under action of psi G. So that means, so this psi G of TV, it has to be in Wi. Okay. But then what does it give? Then what do you get from here? So from here we get that if psi G T of W is in Wi, therefore T inverse psi G T V is in T inverse of Wi, which is just Vi. Okay, but because of commutativity of this square or definition of equivalence of representation, what is this? This is simply your phi g. So that means phi g of V is in Vi. Right? So this proves the proposition. So analogous to the previous proposition, one can also make similar statement for irreducibility and complete reducibility. So I will just write them in a single statement. Proposition. So if phi from G to GLV is equivalent to an irreducible representation, then phi is itself irreducible. Okay, let us call this statement one. And the second statement is, if phi from G to GLV is equivalent to a completely reducible representation, then phi is itself completely reducible. Okay, so the proofs are immediate. So let us come to the point that I was discussing in the last video. I want to show that each representation of a group is equivalent to a representation which has this interesting property, that whenever it has a proper G invariant subspace, then it is decomposable. What is the difference between the two? If a space has a proper G invariant subspace, then there is no reason why it should have a complementary subspace, which is also, which will of course be proper, but which is G invariant. A priori, it's not so clear, but if somehow we can show that this happens, then we are very close to proving our theorem that each representation is a, can be written as a direct sum of irreducible representations. So to do that, we need we need to work with inner product spaces. Alright, so here is the definition. Let V be an inner product space, complex inner product space, a representation phi from G to GLV is called unitary if phi G from V to V is unitary. Okay, for all group elements, for all G in G. So what is the definition of unitary? You may recall that is it preserves inner product. Alright, so inner product space, so let us say say the inner product is, you write like this standard notation. So that means you want that inner product of any two vectors VW should be same as inner product of this transformation applied on those vectors phi G, phi V of W for all group elements, okay, and for all V and W in the vector space V. Alright, so let us see some examples. So let us recall our definition, our representations of cyclic groups of order N. So Z mod NZ. Okay, and you recall that we define representation from this into a one-dimensional representation C star, which is GLC. Okay, and how did I write it? We define phi of any complex phi of M bar as e to power 2 pi I M by N. Look at this representation. All right. So what is this? This the image of each group element here is actually a root of unity. All right. Reality here just correspond to that these lie on the unit circle, and that does lie on the unit circle. In fact, it lie on C1. It belong to the unit circle S1, which is contained in C star. Okay. So this is a unitary representation. In general, a one-dimensional representation of a group G is unitary if and only if its values fall inside the unit circle. Let us see one more example of a unitary representation, the standard representation of the symmetric group. The standard representation of the symmetric group. From symmetric group SN to GLNC. Okay. And recall how did we define it? So you take a permutation sigma in SN and phi sigma is just the permutation matrix. The permutation matrix. What do you need to show that is unitary? You need to see that the image of each group element actually is a unitary matrix. All right. So note that for each sigma in the symmetric group SN, I sigma inverse is just I sigma transpose. Okay, and therefore you have this the definition of unitary matrices. What is that? So that means you have I sigma transpose conjugate, but these are entries are real. So okay, star is same as I sigma star, I sigma is same as identity. And it turns out that for unitary matrices, you have the desired result. So here is a small proposition. So let phi from G to GLV be a unitary representation of a group G. Then phi is either irreducible or decomposable. This is something that we want for each representation. We will see that soon. Okay, and this is very elementary fact. So you are given the representation unitary, okay, and you have to show that either it is irreducible or it is decomposable. So if it is irreducible, we are done. If not, so suppose that it is not irreducible. Suppose that phi is not irreducible. That means that your representation has a proper G invariant subspace. So let W be a proper G invariant subspace of the representation space V. All right. So now since you are working with the inner product spaces, so you have the inner product and now try to make use of that. So take W power to be the orthogonal complement of W in V. That is, all those vector V in the vector space V such that VW inner product is zero for all W in W. Okay. The orthogonal complement of W in V. So my claim is that W perp is also a proper G invariant subspace. All right. So see, because W is a proper G invariant subspace, so W is non-zero and W is not full. So there is something in the complement. So it's W perp is non-zero. Okay. So clearly, W perp is a proper subspace, is basic linear algebra of V. And in fact, you can write V as W direct sum W perp. Okay, this is the elementary fact. Now, only thing you need to check is that whether W perp is G invariant. So take an element in W perp. So let us say let V belong to W perp be an element, okay, and G be an element of the group G. So let us take one W in arbitrary W in W. Then consider the inner product phi G of V, inner product with this, okay, this inner product, and now your representation is given to be unitary. Okay, that means your representation preserves inner product. Each phi g preserves inner product. So this is same as phi g inverse phi g v phi g inverse of W, right? Because phi g inverse, remember that phi g inverse is just phi g inverse, phi of g inverse, because phi is a homomorphism, right? So this is same as inner product of V with phi g inverse of W. But you see, where is little W? Little W is in W and it's g invariant, so phi g inverse of W is again in W. So now this is an element of W and this is an element of W perp, so this has to be zero. Okay, so this shows that thus what you get is W perp is a proper G invariant subspace of V. every representation of a finite group is equivalent to a unitary representation. Proof. Okay, so let G be a finite group and phi from G to GLV a representation, finite dimensional complex representation. Okay, so my claim is that it is equivalent to a unity representation. So that means I need to find another representation of phi from G into GLW, where W has the inner product. So what is the canonical space available to you? It is just Cn, where n is the degree of this representation. So if degree of phi is n, then take W to be Cn. Okay, and we know that if fixing a basis of the vector space V and taking the standard basis of Cn, there is an isomorphism between them, and we can, using that isomorphism, we can define a representation here, which by definition will be equivalent. So fixing a basis of V and the standard basis of W, we have the isomorphism. We have an isomorphism let us call this isomorphism T from V to W. Okay, so what does T do? T take any vector V which is written as a linear span of elements of the basis of V and just map it to the coordinate. Okay, that's what. So I'm not getting into details. All right, now you define psi from G to G GL of your W by psi G equals to the following. So what do you want to do? You take the inverse of the isomorphism, okay, T inverse. All right, then you get from W to V. On V you apply your phi G and you get your T. So this is what, this is actually for each G, this is a map from W to W, right? Okay, and this is of course a homomorphism. They define psi to be like this. Then by definition the psi is equivalent to this, equivalent to your representation phi. Right, all right. So now our given representation, we are now viewing it as a representation into GL of Cn. I think I already said this point, but nevertheless there is no harm in writing it again. Now observe that Cn has a standard Hermitian inner product. What we are going to do is to tweak that inner product a little bit such that my representation psi becomes unitary. All right, so let this be the standard inner product, standard Hermitian inner product on W, which is Cn. All right, then define a new inner product which will show is inner product defined. Let us call this prime from W cross W to C, okay, by the following formula. So what I do is the following, I have to average out. So define V comma W, okay, this prime to be the following. Take the sum over the group elements, okay, take the sum over the group elements and define it to be psi g of v psi g of w. Okay, so my claim is that with this inner product, with this new inner product's prime, the representation, let me write here, psi from G to GLW is unitary. Okay, all right. So we need to first show that this prime is in fact an inner product, and linearity is something very obvious. If you take in the first coordinate alpha v1 plus alpha v2 comma w whole prime, then it is summation over the group element psi g of alpha v1 plus alpha v2, okay, comma psi g of w. But psi g is a linear map, it becomes alpha psi g of v1 plus beta psi g of v2, right? But again, this bigger inner product is a standard inner product, again that is linear, it splits over and it linearity goes through, right? So it's certainly linear. And the second condition is also obvious, let me just write it down for you. So inner product of, let us say, w comma v prime is by definition summation g belonging to group g psi g of w psi g of v. Okay, but now what is this? This is your standard Hermitian inner product. So you can write it as psi g of v psi g of w whole bar, right? But it's a finite sum, you can take the bar over the full, or this is a finite sum of complex numbers, so this is same as whole bar, right? But what is this? This is just v comma w, v comma w prime and is bar. Okay, let's check the non-negativity condition. And also we have v comma v inner product prime is again summation g in the group g, and we have psi g of v psi g of v, this inner product, but this is a standard inner product. Okay, and standard inner product of an element with itself is always non-negative. This is finite sum of non-negative complex real numbers. In fact, it's always a real number. Okay, this is always going to be bigger than or equal to zero. Let's check the last condition. So suppose that inner product of VV, this new inner product, is zero. What does that imply? So that implies that, if and only just write down the value, summation g belonging to group g psi g v psi g v, this inner product is zero. Okay, but now each of this is a non-negative entry. Okay, so this is zero if and only if each of them is zero, if and only if psi g v psi g v, this is zero for all group elements, in particular for identity element, in particular for g equals to 1 of the group g, identity of the group g. So but identity act as identity, right? So this in particular for g equal to this, we have that inner product of vv is zero. But now this is a standard Hermitian inner product, so that implies that v has to be zero. Okay, so thus this from w cross w to c is an inner product. All right, so now to show that it's a unitary representation, we just need to show that each psi g preserves inner product. But that's quite simple, that comes out straight. Now consider this inner product of psi g of v psi g of w, this prime, okay, psi h acting on this vector psi gv and psi h acting on this vector psi g of w and the standard inner product. Okay, all right. But now you see what is this? Psi is a homomorphism, so you can write it as summation h in your group g and psi of hg of v to psi of hg of w, the standard inner Hermitian inner product on Cn. Now you see g is a fixed element of the group g and you are scaling it by the group element, so this total sum will again be the same, right? So basically or you can just do some change of variable and you can see that this is just same as, okay, but what is this? This is just the new inner product v comma w inner product prime. All right, so thus your representation is actually a is equivalent to a unitary representation. Okay, so let me just summarize the proof. What we did, you have a given representation of a group g, okay, into a finite dimensional complex vector space. All right, so you change modify that representation to equivalent representation into the complex vector space Cn, okay, with the standard basis and which has the standard Hermitian inner product. So what we do using this averaging technique, we modify that inner product into a new inner product, and we also check that the representation is in fact unitary. It preserves each element of the group G, in fact preserves the inner product. Okay, so thus every representation is equivalent to a unitary representation. I want to make two important comments here. Comment number one, so we define the new inner product as VW prime equal to summation over group elements and then the standard inner product of psi GV and psi GW. Okay, so this formula works if the group is finite, right? So if the group is finite, this is a well-defined element or it's a well-defined complex number and everything makes sense, right? So you can see you land into problem if the group is infinite. However, if you know that your group has some kind of measure, for example, for locally compact groups, you could have replaced this sum by the integral, okay, or the with respect to appropriate measure. So that's a hint for you that some ideas can be generalized to locally compact groups. Okay, finite groups are of course locally compact with discrete topology. In fact, they are compact. And the second thing is, if instead of the field of complex numbers, if you work with a field whose characteristic divide order of the group G, then this approach will fail. This prime, this new inner product, so-called inner product will fail to be an inner product. Why? Since for any v, take a non-zero vector v in the vector space w, which is fixed by all group element. Okay, suppose you have a representation where you have a group element which is fixed by all elements. Okay, and then if you take this sum, summation of this inner product, the vector v with itself, and add it as many for each group element, then this is order of the group times this. Now, since the characteristic of the field divide this, so it is characteristic of the field times and some integer times VV, but that becomes zero. But your vector is non-zero. Okay. So the approach will fail if the characteristic of the field divide order of the group G. And if the characteristic of the field does not divide order of the group G, the same approach works. So you can see that you can actually generalize this result to an arbitrary field whose characteristic does not divide out of the group G and when the group is finite. Okay, so this is just a side remark. All right, so having done this, we can have some consequence of this. Let me just write it as a proposition. So every representation phi from G to GLV of a group G is either irreducible or decomposable. This is an immediate consequence, right? So take a representation of your finite group G into GLV, okay? And we know that every such representation is equivalent to a unitary representation. But for unitary representation, we know that it is either irreducible or complete, or it is decomposable. And we also know that irreducibility and decomposability complete reducibility, they all are invariant under equivalence of representations. I want to make one more remark here, that the result that every representation of a finite group is equivalent to a unitary representation fails to be true for infinite groups. Okay. Let us see an example. So take the group to be the additive group of integers. Okay, and take phi to be a representation into GL2C given by phi n, phi of any integer, it to be this matrix 1 n 0 1. You can easily check that it's indeed a group homomorphism, a representation. So this representation is not equivalent to a unitary representation, for if it were equivalent to a unitary representation, then by this proposition preceding proposition, it would be either irreducible or decomposable. But I will convince you that this representation is neither irreducible nor it is decomposable. So the representation phi from integers to GL to C is not irreducible. Why it is not irreducible? Let me give a G invariant subspace. So take your subspace spanned by E1. Spanned by this. And you can see that it is not, invariant. It is certainly a proper invariant subspace because it's one dimensional. Okay. And it's invariant because phi n of E1 is what? It is 1 n 0 1. This matrix acting on, I write it as a column vector, and you can check it is what? First row, first column, it is 1, 0. It is invariant. So you have a proper G invariant subspace. Okay, this happens for all n in integers. So therefore, your representation is not irreducible. And secondly, phi is not decomposable. Why it is not decomposable? So because if phi were decomposable, that means then your vector space C2 can be written as V direct sum W, where V and W are two proper G invariant subspaces, right? So therefore each V and W has to be one dimensional, right? So dimension of V equals to dimension of W has to be one in that case. If it were decomposable, right? But then because these are invariant subspaces, so therefore your representation phi would be equivalent to phi 1 direct sum with phi 2, okay, where phi 1 is just phi restricted to V and phi 2 is just phi restricted to W. That means what? That means that the matrix of phi for any integer n would be the block matrix. The matrix phi 1 of n, 0, 0, and phi 2 of n. Right? So this is a diagonal matrix. So if phi were decomposable, then for each integer n, phi n would be represented by a diagonal matrix. But you know that, let us say phi 1, which is this matrix 1, 1, 0, 1, is not diagonalizable. Okay. And you can use elementary linear algebra to check that, because you can check that its minimal polynomial is what? You can check its minimal polynomial is x minus 1 whole square, and which has repeated root. All right. Therefore, when you are proving results about representation of finite groups, one need to be really careful, and also one should ask question which results would really pass on to infinite groups and so on. All right. As promised in the beginning, I would like to finish with Maastricht's theorem. It's a beautiful theorem, and it says that every representation of a finite group is completely reducible. Every representation of a finite group is completely reducible. So let us prove it. So let phi from G to GLV be a unitary representation . Recall that we showed that every representation is equivalent to a unitary representation, and equivalent representation preserve complete reducibility. So I can assume that my representation is a unitary representation. Alright, so unitary representation, and we will proceed by dimension induction on the degree of the representation. So if degree of phi is 1, then it has to be reducible. Every degree 1 representation is irreducible. Then phi is irreducible and we are done. Okay. Suppose the result is true, suppose the assertion holds, if degree of phi is less than or equal to n. Okay, so you have now a representation whose degree is as promised, I would like to finish with Marschke's theorem. It's a beautiful theorem and says that every representation of a finite group is completely reducible. That is, given a representation of a finite group, you can write it as a direct sum of irreducible representations. So proof. So let phi from G to GLV be a unitary representation. Recall that without loss of generality, I can always assume that my representation is a unitary representation, since I showed that each representation is equivalent to a unitary representation. So we shall proceed by induction on the degree of the representation. If the degree of the representation is 1, then there is nothing to prove because it has to be irreducible. A one-dimensional space cannot have any proper G-invariant subspace. Suppose the assertion holds for all representations whose degree is less than degree of n. Okay, if the degree of your given representation. Right. So now I know that for a unitary representation, either it is irreducible or it is decomposable. So if the representation itself is irreducible, again we are done. Okay. If not, then it is decomposable. Therefore, your space V can be written as direct sum of two proper G-invariant subspaces. Okay. And each of them is proper, therefore dimension of each of this wi is strictly less than dimension of your vector space v, which is your degree of your representation, degree of phi. Okay, so by induction hypothesis, phi restricted to w1 and phi restricted to w2 are completely reducible. They can be written as a direct sum of reducibles. And since phi can be written as phi restricted to w1 direct sum phi restricted to w2, and each of these summand phi restricted to w1 and phi restricted to w2 is completely reducible, this implies that phi is completely reducible. Okay, so this completes proof of Marschke's theorem. I finished this lecture here.